I can't believe we have such a big crowd here tonight. Can you hear me okay? Great. So thank you to Rock for Israel for inviting me here and for getting such a large crowd out to hear me. Thank you also to the Jewish Community Center for giving us the space and for hosting this event. The speech tonight is really going to talk about two aspects of the boycott, divest, and sanctions movement. On the one hand, there's the student side, which is the pleasant videos you've just watched. And there's also the faculty side, which is what I refer to as the academic boycott movement. They're somewhat related. They're both part of the same international movement, but they hold very different events in very different aspects. The BDS movement encompasses a lot of different things, particularly on the student side. There's boycotts of hummus. You might have read in the newspaper that they've been trying to get sabra hummus kicked out of school dining halls and things like that. There's motions to divest from Caterpillar, because Caterpillar has very large tractors and bulldozers that they say are being used to deprive Palestinians of their human rights. And on the faculty side, there is no movement at a university. There's no university considering the boycott of Israel, but it's professional associations, and the one I'll focus on tonight is the American Studies Association. But before I get into these specifics, in every time I give one of these speeches, there's a variety of people in the audience. And for the people in the audience who would think of themselves as pro-Israel, particularly if there are students here or parents of students, the message that I have to you, and I want you to keep in mind, is that you're not alone. That on college campuses, the sort of things you saw go on the video are not representative of the United States as a whole. In fact, Israel is as popular, if not more popular, in the United States as a whole than it's ever been. I track, or I follow, I should say, the Gallup surveys that come out every March. And we'll see what the next one holds. But the last Gallup survey from just under a year ago showed that Israel's favorability rating was higher than it has ever been. It literally was at the top. It was a 72% favorability rating. Other than a small handful of countries like Canada and England and a few others, Israel had the most favorable view in the United States. The Palestinian Authority, by contrast, had a 19% favorability as opposed to 72%. And just to give you a little bit of perspective, and it's not the same methodology, so it may not be completely apples to apples, but there was also a survey last spring taken, and the favorability rating of kittens in the United States is 71%. So Israel is actually 1% more popular than kittens in the United States. But you wouldn't know that on some college campuses. You wouldn't know that at all. Did the Gaza war over the summer change that? My hunch is not really. There were some flash polls over the summer, which might have indicated a mild lessening of support, but I don't think it will make much of a difference. So Israel is doing pretty well nationally in the United States. The Israel is also less isolated in many ways. We hear a lot about the economic boycott movement in Europe. Really hasn't taken off. Not to say there aren't pockets of support there, but Israel's exports to the EU are actually up compared to prior years. And Israel has just opened up trade agreements and political agreements with India particularly, and also China. So to those of you who are pro-Israel, I don't want you to get depressed by watching movies like we just showed of people screaming on campuses. And I'll talk more about that, but it's not representative of the country as a whole. For those of you here, and I hope there are some undecided voters here, I simply ask you to keep an open mind that just because you hear certain phrases repeated in the media, like apartheid state, apartheid wall, just because it's repeated over and over and over again, doesn't make it so. And I just ask you to do your own investigation and read both sides and come to your own conclusions. And to those in the audience, and I hope there are some who would consider themselves pro-BDS, who think the BDS movement is a good thing, one, thank you for coming, because I'm always happy to talk to people who disagree. But more important, I don't expect to change your mind. It's not like flicking a light switch on the wall and all of a sudden the light's gone. I would just ask you to consider at the end of my talk whether the BDS movement is doing more harm than it is good, and that the primary victims of the BDS movement are the Palestinians themselves, not the Israelis, because the BDS movement reinforces a conflict and a rejectionism that has not served the Palestinians, the Arabs of the British Mandate, well over the decades. And I don't think it will in the coming years either. So what you've just seen on the video is the bad news on campus. And by the way, I will take questions at the end, and I hope there are plenty of questions. The bad news on the campus, though, is offset or is reflective of an increasing aggressiveness on certain campuses. But do keep in mind, it's a limited number of campuses, and there have been a number of incidents of very aggressive sort of behavior. The good news is that, for the most part, it has not spread very far beyond a couple of dozen to three dozen campuses. That's not to say for lack of trying, and that's not to say it won't change and spread more, but they tend to be very high-profile campuses. University of Michigan, Columbia, UC system. And so they're always in the news, but you will be getting a false impression that this is a national problem. It's a problem for sure, but it's a problem at certain campuses. The divestment motions that are brought before student assemblies have mostly failed. They've passed a few places, but most, two-thirds to three-quarters of them have failed. And of course, to some extent, it's arguing over, in the real world, nothing, because none of these student assemblies have the power to divest anyway. And they're always rejected on the handful of times when they pass, they're rejected by the administration, by the trustees, by the presidents, who all of whom have a fiduciary duty to invest the school's funds. The tactics have changed, as I've seen it from year to year, because at the undergraduate level, student assembly level, they have mostly failed. They've shifted tactics, and now they're going to graduate student associations. They were successful at getting the University of California teaching assistant union to pass a boycott resolution. And there's something instructive there. It's been rejected. It's a UAW affiliate. It's been rejected by national UAW. It's been rejected by the Cal system. But the problem that we face as Israel advocates on campus is that the other side tends to be more focused and more motivated. That from my observations, and it's not something I've measured, just my anecdotal observations, the students who are anti-Israel tend to devote enormous amounts of their time to it. It's essentially what they do. Whether it's Students for Justice in Palestine, which you may be referred to as SJP, whether it's faculty members who are anti-Israel, or whether it's community activists who go onto campus, like the woman in the video who threatened somebody against whom a police complaint was filed, is an Ithaca area anti-Israel activist who comes onto campus and works with the students on campus. So they tend to be much more organized. In that grad student vote for the UAW, and I'm going to use approximate numbers, I think I'm in the range, they only had about 20% of the eligible voters vote. And not surprisingly, the majority of the ones who voted were the motivated anti-Israel advocates, and particularly on the UC Berkeley campus. So UC Berkeley put in like 500 votes above and beyond for that boycott. So while it got a lot of press, that UAW graduate student boycott was essentially a UC Berkeley boycott vote. They got their people out, and you know, give them credit, they got their voters out. But we've seen that time and again, that very few people participate. Indifference is probably the prevailing political wisdom on most campuses, and if you have a small group who are motivated, you can create a lot of noise and an impact. The other tactic that they've been using very recently is to try to co-opt and to try to hijack, is the word I use, the Black Lives Matter movement and the Ferguson movement. So I've documented this extensively at my website. They have actually sent contingents of people to join the protests in Ferguson. and they have tried to portray the Ferguson movement and the Black Lives Matter movement as anti-Israel movements. And if you heard on the news, you may not have, but a group on Martin Luther King Jr. Day blocked the San Mateo Bridge, trapped people on the bridge for hours. Could have been a very, very dangerous situation if someone needed medical attention. And they draped a Palestinian flag across both sides of the bridge at its highest span point. So they took a protest for Martin Luther King Day, mostly attended by Black Lives Matter protesters, and they turned it into a pro-Palestinian protest. And so that's something that you're seeing at many campuses, and they're doing it deliberately. If you read what they say on their websites, this is a tactic they're using. And they're having to do those sort of things because, for the most part, people are sick and tired of them on campuses. People are sick and tired of them dominating student assemblies, disrupting events, disrupting speakers. They do more harm for their own cause by doing those sort of actions than anything else. But it's something that needs to be fought because there is a very aggressive plan that they have to expand way beyond the 2 to 3 dozen campuses where these student groups are very active. So Students for Justice in Palestine is now, I think, on 80 campuses, and they're expanding very rapidly. So we fight these movements because while they may be small now, we want to keep them small. And we want to keep them losing divestment votes, but it's something that's a real challenge on campuses. And a lot of students feel very intimidated. You've seen some of the players on the videos who have the megaphones, literally the megaphones, and it's very intimidating for a lot of students to confront that. But I think we're making a lot of progress there. The area where the boycott movement actually has its greatest strength is not, you know, in the student cafeteria, it's in the faculty lounge. And therefore, I'm going to talk to you mostly tonight about the academic boycott, because that's the only place it has any traction whatsoever and a wide sort of ranging breadth to it. I will also say to you, in terms of this not being, you know, depressed about the situation, that over the summer, or very late summer, it was really after the Gaza fighting had ended, former ambassador to the U.S., Israeli ambassador, Michael Oren, was interviewed in the New York Times, and the question to him was essentially that, you know, Israel can't afford a war of attrition with Gaza, and Israel has to put an end to this right now. And his response, I thought, was very interesting, and it's really my approach to this whole BDS movement, which is, quoting him, "There's a long-standing conventional wisdom that Israel doesn't do well in wars of attrition. That overlooks a broader historical view that Israel's entire existence has been a war of attrition, and we've won." And that's really the way I view the campus student BDS movement. It's a war of attrition. They're entitled to say what they want to say. They're not entitled to shut other people down, but they're entitled to their opinions, they're entitled to express them, but it's something that's never going to go away, and we just have to keep addressing it as it comes on, much like a war of attrition. The reason I think that this ultimately backfires against the Palestinians is that, again, it reinforces a rejectionism. It's one over the other, and that they're really, this rejectionism has gotten the Palestinians a lot less than they could have gotten in 1947 had they gone along with the UN partition plan. What they're arguing for now and fighting for now is much less, and so the rejectionism hasn't really helped them. The academic boycott, somebody asked me, we had a dinner beforehand, you know, how did you get involved in these things? How did you find this BDS movement? And I didn't really find the BDS movement, it found me. I've been covering BDS over the years at the website, the Sabra Hummus boycotts and things like that. And frankly, I hope they keep serving Sabra Hummus, which is made in Virginia. It was founded by a company in White Plains, New York. It has no Israeli employees. It has an investor, which is Israeli, and that's why they're trying to boycott it. I even saw something on, they're starting a Central New York group is starting a movement to ban Sabra Hummus from Green Star Co-op. It's like a food co-op in Ithaca. And they've even put out literature claiming that the brand Sabra was named after the Sabra and Shatila massacre in Lebanon. I mean, that's the sort of propaganda we face. Of course it's not. Sabra is a very common term referring to native-born Israelis who are rough on the outside, sweet on the inside, that, whether you like the name or not, to go around peddling that, that was named after the massacre, is the sort of things that we face. But those are the sort of things I covered for years. But I didn't really get involved in academic boycotts because until 2013, there really were none. There was, in May of 2013, the Association for Asian American Studies, I may have gotten the sequence of words wrong, passed a boycott call. It was a very small group. It was literally 100 people at their annual meeting showed up in a conference room and took a vote, and it was unanimous, which should tell you right there that it was only those who were interested showed up. Nobody noticed it except for us, and we started sounding the alarm a little, but nobody listened. That what we knew what the tactic would be, because we were reading what they said, and the tactic would be they'd take a small victory from an organization no one had ever heard of, that has a small membership, and they would then try to ratchet it up and leverage it. And that's exactly what they did. They then went to the American Studies Association towards the end of the year, which is a much bigger organization. So whereas the Asian American Studies group had, I think, 400 members, the American Studies Association had about 4,000 voting members. And by their own admission, in their interviews, they spent 4 years planning the boycott. First, they created an activism committee. Then they took over the National Council by getting their people elected. It was a slow, multi-year process. So by the time they were ready to bring the boycott forward, they controlled all the key mechanisms in the organization. And the pro-Israel members found out about it about a month before the vote. And when pro-Israel members asked that the pro-Israel, or I should say anti-boycott material be sent to the membership along with the pro-boycott, the National Council refused. So it was again a situation where those who showed up prevailed, and of 4,000 eligible voters, only 1,200 voted, and it was online. And of 800 of the 1,200, the core group of BDS, who only represented about 20% of the organization, actually got it passed. And that's when I woke up to this movement. And I woke up to it because it was so alien to everything that I had in my experiences. My experience was I went to Hamilton College and graduated in 1981, studied Soviet Union, Russian language, and I went, actually studied at Middlebury College, and I went and I studied in the Soviet Union, got a Russian language degree there through Middlebury College. And the Soviet Union, you all know, in this room, in college campuses, people don't really know what the Soviet Union was, but the Soviet Union, several million or more people died in the forced collectivization in Ukraine. Students don't know about that. The Gulag Archipelago, that vast sea of prison camps throughout the country. The deportation of entire nationalities. People wonder, why is the Crimea 99.5% Russian speaking now? Before, which was Putin's excuse for taking it back from Ukraine. Well, the reason is that in 1945, Stalin shipped the entire Crimean Tatar national population to Central Asia and to Uzbek and to Siberia. They literally put them on trucks and buses and trains and shipped an entire national population out of the Crimea. Nobody knows about that. The capture of the Baltic states, the invasion of Finland and Hungary, Czechoslovakia, the complete lack of academic freedom. There was zero, you had to be a Communist Party member to advance in the Soviet university system, and if you said one word of dissent, your career was over and you'd probably lose your job. Lack of freedom of movement, the fact that you couldn't just pick up and say, well, I'm kind of tired of Moscow, I think I'd like to go to Leningrad. It didn't work that way. You'd have to get permission to move. And of course, their invasion of Afghanistan. I was actually with Middlebury on the last Soviet airflow flight out of New York City. They had just invaded Afghanistan, and the US had closed the Soviet consulate in New York. So our group of 10 Americans was on a huge Soviet airliner with about 100 diplomats and their families who had just been kicked out of the country. So you add all of those things up. The worst things they say about Israel were dwarfed by the truth of the Soviet Union. And I don't recall anybody talking about an academic boycott. Yes, we boycott their Olympics. Yes, we boycott whatever it happens to be. But we were desperate to have that academic contact with them. We wanted to go over there and meet their students and meet their faculty. We wanted their faculty to come over to Middlebury's Russian language school over the summer and teach us. And we knew what the game was. They were all cleared by the KGB. They could only come over individually, not with their families, because they didn't want defectors. They probably were reporting on us, maybe not every single student, but some of us. So with all of these, this parade of horribles, nobody was talking about an academic boycott of the Soviet Union. We view that academic interaction as a positive. We view that our being able to speak to their people, even if they couldn't admit their minds were being changed, as fundamentally important. And it was extremely important to the academic side of what we did. And I would have been dead set against an academic boycott of the Soviet Union, even if I would have been, and I don't recall if I was or not, in favor of the boycott of their Olympics. It's a totally different thing. And that's why the academic boycott is so much different than boycotting Sabra hummus. We don't want to eat Sabra hummus, go buy Wegmans bread. We don't care. We think it's nasty that you spread this sort of propaganda, and we will tell people the truth about it. But ultimately, it's not the same as an academic boycott, because an academic boycott affects other people's rights as well. And that's why the American Association of University Professors has come out consistently for decades against systematic academic boycotts. And they came out against it decades ago, and they came out against the American Studies Association academic boycott, because they find that systematic academic boycotts violate the free exchange of ideas among academics, and that the core concept of academic freedom means that free exchange, quoting, irrespective of governmental policies and however unpalatable those policies may be viewed. And that has been the standard that we've always applied. And it was the standard applied in the United States, even to South Africa. There may have been individuals who in their own conscience chose to boycott South African institutions. There may have been specific programs or universities. But there was never the sort of systematic academic boycott that they're now calling for against Israel. The AAUP, again, American Association of University Professors, further wrote that when such non-cooperation takes the form of a systematic academic boycott, it threatens the principles of free expression and communication on which we collectively depend. And that's an important definition, and that's why I keep talking about systematic academic boycotts. No individual should be forced to deal with any country. If you don't want to deal with Israel, don't deal with Israel. That's different than a systematic boycott where you deprive everyone of that choice. I will be against a systematic academic boycott of Iran, despite how horrible that country's government is. I would welcome interaction with Iranian academics. I think it would be a vote for liberty and a vote for freedom for the Iranian people to have that sort of free interaction. I'd be against an academic boycott of China, despite its horrible academic freedom policies, despite its occupation of Tibet, despite other things it's done in its history. I'd be against, dead set against, the boycott of Palestinian universities. If anybody suggested that to me, I would be as against that as I am against the boycott of Israeli universities, despite the fact that at Al-Quds University a couple of weeks ago, the Hamas student group made a film glorifying the killing of the four Jews at the synagogue in Jerusalem. Despite the fact that at Herzliya University, they constructed a mock Sparrow pizza restaurant to celebrate the explosion at the Sparrow restaurant. Despite all of those things, despite the fact that they don't have academic freedom as we understand it, try being pro-Zionist at a Hamas-controlled university in Gaza. But I'd be against boycotting Gaza universities. and I would welcome interaction with their academics and their students. And the history of boycotts is something that should reinforce that view. The history of the boycotts in what was then British Mandate Palestine started at least as early as the 1920s. You can find articles in the Palestine Post, later known as the Jerusalem Post, about the boycott of Jewish businesses in the 1920s. The Arab League boycott. The Arab League was formed in 1944. The Arab League boycott started in 1945. There wasn't even a country called Israel, but they were already boycotted. And it was a boycott of Jews in the land of Israel. The modern boycott started in 2001. You may read that they say that the current boycott is a response to a call from a 2005 call from Palestinian civil society. That's actually not true. The current boycott movement, boycott, divest, and sanction movement, started at the 2001 Durban non-governmental organization meeting, NGO meeting, which was so anti-Semitic, blatantly, that the U.S. walked out on it. The late Congressman Tom Lantos wrote extensively, because he attended it, about what he saw there that led up to the boycott call. And I'm not going to read a lot of it, but I'll read you one little section. I don't want to run too late tonight. Each day, these groups organized anti-Israel and anti-Semitic rallies around the meetings, attracting thousands. One flyer, which was widely distributed, showed a photograph of Hitler and the question, "What if I had won?" The answer, "There'd be no Israel." At a press conference held by Jewish NGOs to discuss their concerns with the direction the conference was taking, an accredited non-governmental organization, the Arab Lawyers Union, distributed a booklet filled with anti-Semitic caricatures, frighteningly like those seen in Nazi hate literature printed in the 1930s. Sadly, but perhaps not surprisingly, the official NGO document that was later adopted by a majority at the forum branded Israel a racist apartheid state, guilty of genocide, and called for an end to its racist crimes, and it also called for the international BDS boycott of Israel. The final document issued by that anti-Semitic NGO conference is the founding document of the BDS movement. Paragraphs 423 and 424, and I'll only read a couple of sentences for you, they call for the launch of an international anti-Israeli apartheid movement as implemented against South African apartheid through a global solidarity campaign of international civil society. They call upon the international community to impose a policy of complete and total isolation of Israel as an apartheid state. So this notion of calling Israel an apartheid state, of boycotting Israel, it didn't just spring up. It was planned. And by the way, Mary Robinson, who is not former UN High Commissioner for Human Rights, who is not known to be a friend of Israel, was so horrified at what went on at that conference that she famously held up that booklet that the Arab Lawyers Union was passing around and said, "Today I'm a Jew." That is the founding conference of the current BDS movement. They issued subsequent interim calls for a boycott, including in 2004, but it took them 2 to 3 years to gather up the Palestinian civil society organizations into the 2005 final call for a boycott and final declaration of boycott. And that is the final declaration that calls upon, says, "We, representatives of Palestinian civil society, call upon international civil society, et cetera, to implement a full range of boycotts similar to implemented against apartheid South Africa." There has been a decade plus long attempt to portray Israel as an apartheid state. It's not, I'll get into that in a minute, but it was found that theme, that strategy, was formed at the Durban Conference. It didn't just happen. In 2005, they also issued their guidelines for the boycott, including the academic boycott guidelines. The academic boycott guidelines and the call from Palestinian civil society in 2005 is the boycott that the American Studies Association agreed to. In their resolution, they agreed to abide by the 2005 boycott call. Some of the Palestinian Campaign for the Cultural and Academic Boycott of Israel has a long list of what their academic boycott consists of. I'll read you some of it. It was recently updated, and I'll point out a couple of things about the update. It insists that people refrain from participation in any form of academic, cultural collaboration or joint projects with Israeli institutions. Calls for the cancellation or prohibiting Israelis from academic events such as conferences, symposia, workshops, book and museum exhibits, if sponsored by an Israeli institution. Calls for the cessation of international cooperation agreements with Israeli universities, including exchange of faculty and students. Calls for the cancellation of study abroad programs in Israel. Calls for barring official representatives of Israeli universities from international conferences. It bans Palestinian and Israeli collaborative academic projects. It calls for prohibiting Israeli institutions from membership in world bodies. And this one, to me, in many ways, is the most chilling. It bans publishing in or refereeing articles for academic journals based at Israeli universities. It's not quite book burning, but it's close to it. What I have just read to you is what the American Studies Association agreed to. Even that was too much for their membership, because when that resolution was put forward, even the anti-Israeli people in the organization said, wait a second, this is too much for us. This is really horrible. So what they did is they purported to issue guidelines. They didn't change their resolution, but they issued, literally they called them talking points. They issued talking points which purported to scale back that this would not apply to Israeli individual faculty members so long as they were not acting on behalf of their institution and had no official capacity at the institution. That is a distinction that is made for no other nationality. You could come here from Iran and be the dean of the University of Tehran, assuming there is such a position, or the rector, and the American Studies Association would have been fine with you. But if you're the dean of Tel Aviv University, or you're a representative of the American Studies Department at Haifa University, you would be barred. That changed this fall, because they were holding their annual meeting in California, and they were challenged legally. Never got to a lawsuit, but they backed down because that violated California law. But that was their original intention. The boycott was actually expanded this summer. They purported to clarify it, but it actually, if you read it, it's actually an expansion. I'm not going to go over everything. Everything I've just read to you still applies. But they have also come out against any academic projects or activities that accepts funding from Israel, its lobby groups, or complicit institutions. I'm not sure what that all means, but they have expanded the boycott. It's now not only that it's supported by Israeli academic institutions, by what they call its lobby groups, the so-called Jewish lobby, or the Israel lobby, or complicit institutions. I don't know what that means, but it's been broadened. They also now bar, and think about this, they bar normalization projects. They bar, and examples of which, so anything that would normalize relations between Israeli Jews and Palestinians, or Israelis generally and Palestinians, is now barred under these guidelines. Quote, examples include events, projects, or publications that are designed so they can present their respective narratives or perspectives, or to work towards reconciliation without addressing the root cause of injustice and the requirements of justice. So under this, you can't have a panel discussion where there's the Israeli view, there's the middle view, there's the Palestinian view. That is considered normalization, and they are now against it. That's how in-depth, and that's why I call the BDS movement a war movement, not a peace movement. They opposed, Technion held a MOOC, mass online something or something, but where people participate online, run by an Israeli Arab professor at Technion to introduce nanotechnology throughout the Arab and Muslim world where they didn't have the professors to teach it. They were against that interaction. There was a conference over the summer, and I wrote about this, where they were bringing online Palestinian students and Israeli students to talk to each other. They boycotted that. The BDS movement is not about peace. It is about war by other means, and the boycott is that other means. The goal, just listen to what their leaders say. Listen to what Omar Barghouti, the founder of the movement, says. The goal is the destruction of Israel as a Jewish majority state. That sounds, well, everybody just participates and will just be a democracy for everything, for everybody. How's that worked out anywhere in the Middle East? And why is it only when the national aspiration is from Jews that it's all of a sudden bad? But it's not bad when it's from Egyptians or when it's from any other Muslim country. Who gets harmed by this academic boycott? And this gets back to what the American Association of University Professors is talking about. It's not like Sabra hummus. When you destroy the academic system, it has ripple effects throughout. So obviously Israelis are harmed by it, Israeli scholars. But maybe the boycott people don't care about Israeli scholars, so that's not really a persuasive point for them. But it affects U.S. universities and scholars. Many universities have joint programs with Israeli academic institutions. I believe it's Rochester Institute of Technology participates in a joint program with three or four other international universities, one of whom is Technion, so that they can exchange ideas on medical technology. Gone. Study abroad programs, gone. The ability of Jewish studies departments to conduct their part of their research, gone. At every level, in science, technology, and elsewhere, if you implement this boycott, then all of those university programs go away, and all of those interactions go away. The general academic community is the one who suffers. But it's not just the academic community, it's the students. And when I speak to student groups, I drive this point home. When they cancel that program because they're anti-normalization or they're anti-cooperation, they are making the choice for you. They are depriving you of the choice to direct your own education. They're telling you who you can study with, what you can read, where you can go, and who you can interact with. By what right do others have the right to do that to you? Once those programs disappear, you don't have the choice to go on them anymore. And so this is a student issue as well, and that's why it's not like boycotting Sabra hummus. My message to students is that your faculty, who are the driving force in these things, believe me, the faculty are the driving force in these things. It's have no right to take those decisions away from students. Fortunately, the academic boycott has not spread very far. After the American Studies Association, over 250 university presidents came out with statements denouncing and rejecting the boycott. Some mild, some very strong. The American Council on Education came out against it. They represent virtually every higher educational institution in the country, 2,000. I didn't even know there were 2,000, but they represent them. They came out against it. The American Association of University Professors came out against it. The American Association of Universities came out against it. And many other groups came out against it. And so the good thing was that within about a three-week period of time from when the American Studies Association passed it, and at that point, the public narrative was This is the wave of the future. It's unstoppable. It just passed this organization. Who is next? Within 3 weeks, the New York Times used the word pariah to refer to the American Studies Association. And that's how quickly the narrative changed. But they keep on trying. They went to the Modern Language Association. Remember I told you their tactic is get a small victory, take it to a bigger organization. Get another victory, take it to a bigger organization. They've gone to the Modern Language Association, and they very, very tactfully consider it when they do it. Not tactful, but they have very good tactics. They will start in baby steps. First, there'll be a resolution criticizing Israel for denying Palestinians academic freedom, based on a lot of faulty facts and faulty assumptions. And then they'll jump it up a year later or 2 years later to a full boycott resolution. Well, the boycott, the criticism of the Israeli educational system was fought at Modern Language Association. We weren't asleep like we were for the American Studies Association, and it was defeated at Modern Language. And Modern Language this year voted to put off the boycott resolution till 2017. They tried to take it to the American Historical Association this month. They got voted down. They tried to take it to, they're trying to take it now to the American Anthropological Association. Again, it's going to be those baby steps. First, open it up for discussion, then a criticism referendum, and then so on. But it hasn't spread, other than some very tiny organizations of professors. It hasn't spread anywhere. I don't think it's over, this battle, because you, as with the American Studies Association, you can, a relatively small group of people can take over an organization. If they're smart and they take over the key committees and they get their people elected to key positions in the organization. And the American Studies Association is actually a great example of how a relatively small radical group can take over a fairly moderate institution. So why is Israel singled out? I mean, that's always the question. It's not really the question that I like to start with, because you've noticed I've not really talked about that. The fact that Israel is unfairly singled out is really the last point. It's not the first point. The academic boycott is bad, whether it's against Israel or Iran or Soviet Union or anybody else. The tactics they use on campus are bad. But why is Israel singled out? Of all the insane human rights crimes that are taking place around the world, of all the regimes, I mean, my goodness, Syria, 200,000, 300,000 people killed, the country destroyed, Saudi Arabia, where they execute people for things that aren't even crimes here. I mean, of all of the things going on in the world, why is Israel singled out? And they'll give you several responses. And the first thing they'll say is, well, Israel, we were asked to do it. I mean, literally, that is the most common response you will get from an academic who supports the boycott when asked, why are you singling out Israel? And in fact, the former president of the American Studies Association, a professor out in California, when asked a similar question, said, well, we have to start someplace. But of course, they start that someplace they're starting is, of course, the place they end as well. But why? Why is Israel singled out? They say, well, Israel's a settler colonial state, and therefore it deserves special negative treatment. But if you look at what they say about Israel, you could say the same thing about the United States. We may be standing right now on ground that belonged to a Native American tribe at one point.
Seneca.
Virtually every university in this country is situated on Native land. Virtually, think about what the U.S. has done, our history of slavery, of segregation, of invading other countries, of capturing and maintaining colonies like Puerto Rico or Guam. If every single reason you could give for boycotting Israeli academic institutions, our academic institutions have defense contracts. They participate in the development of products that kill people and maintain surveillance over people.
every single argument you could make to Israeli institutions could be made to the U.S. and most of Western Europe. So why aren't you boycotting your own university? That's always my question for them. Put your money where your mouth is. Quit your job and stop working for your settler colonial university. And they said, well, nobody has asked us. So when I went to Vassar, I announced, I'm asking you to quit. The 39 professors who signed the boycott letter and who put in their letter in the Vassar student newspaper that they would consider boycotting their own university if asked to do so. I asked you to do so. Not one of them did. Then they'll say, U.S. aid to Israel. That's another big response you get. Well, we have a special obligation to be harsh on Israel, more harsh than we are on China or someplace else, because they are the biggest recipient of U.S. military aid. That's a kernel of truth to it. If you look at a budgetary item called military aid, Israel is the largest. But we spend far more defending South Korea. We spend far more stationing troops in Germany, still waiting for those 5,000 Soviet tanks to come across the plains. We spend far more defending Japan and maintaining military bases there. So it is not true that we spend more money on Israel. It is true there's a budgetary item called U.S. military aid, or whatever it's called, and Israel's the biggest recipient. But it is not true that Israel benefits more from our largesse than other countries. It's also not true that Israel receives that money and just keeps it. At least 70% of that money, it might be 80%, has to be spent back in the United States. That's the scheme of military aid. It supports the U.S. defense industry. And we also have joint missile defense projects with Israel. The Palestinians also receive almost $500 million of aid from the U.S., most of it non-military, so they keep most of it, or at least they ship some of it off to Swiss bank accounts, but they keep it. And per capita, while on straight dollars, Israel receives 6 or 7 or 8 times what the Palestinians receive, per capita, it's about twice as much as the Palestinians receive. So it's more, no doubt about that, but it's not wildly more. So that excuse doesn't hold up. They say that Israel has destroyed Palestinian education, particularly higher education. It's depriving people of the ability to get an education. Who here knows how many universities there were in Gaza and the West Bank prior to 1967?
Zero.
Zero. There are 20 plus now, including some that are thriving. All in the West Bank and in Gaza. They say that the Israeli checkpoints and other things interfere with students' ability to get to campus, etc. And I have no doubt that's true. But of course, they will never tell you why those were set up in the first place, because of the horrible suicide bombing campaign that took place. They'll say that Israel's an apartheid state. And this is one which has penetrated. It started back in 2001, and it's penetrated. Even John Kerry, even some Israeli politicians say, well, if Israel were to absorb the West Bank and give everybody voting rights, it would become an apartheid state, whatever. Apartheid is a very deliberate, a very specific definition in international law. And there is no question that Israel is not an apartheid state, because the International Convention on the Suppression and Punishment of the Crime of Apartheid talks about similar policies and practices of racial segregation and discrimination as practiced in Southern Africa. The Rome Statute talks about domination and control by one racial group over any other racial group or groups. Whatever you have in Israel, you do not have a racial division. You have a religious division. Just that like takes place in many countries in the world. That takes place in Iraq between the Sunni and the Shiites. You have a multiracial society which went to great lengths to rescue communities, including African Jewish communities. Is it a perfect model of racial tolerance? No. Is the United States? No. Is Western Europe? No. Are Arab countries? No. So there's no truth to the argument. Moreover, Israel is a majority-ruled country. It's not a minority-ruled country like South Africa. Since when is majority rule? If majority rule by one religious group constitutes apartheid, then every single Muslim country is guilty of it. But you never hear them say that. They say that different laws are applied in the West Bank than in Israel. That's true. And that's, a lot of people argue, that's required by international law. Until such time, if it ever happens, that Israel annexes the West Bank and gives those people their full citizen rights, they have to maintain a separate set of laws. Otherwise, they've annexed the country. They complain about the apartheid wall. They've set up apartheid walls on campuses. Never once will they discuss why that was created. If Israel just wanted to make life difficult for people, why did it wait until 2003 to start building it? Because in 2002, 452 Israeli civilians were killed by suicide bombers from the West Bank. You'll never hear that. You'll never see a mock suicide bomber at the mock apartheid wall. I could go on and on, but I won't. There are other issues that I could talk about. They claim that Israel is an apartheid state because it maintains discriminatory laws, such as maintaining a Jewish star on the flag. That's one of the 50 laws they say is discriminatory. Let's cut to the chase here. Why is Israel singled out? It's singled out because it's the only Jewish national entity in the Muslim Middle East. If it were any other religious group, maybe even Christian, it wouldn't be singled out the way it is now. And that's the bottom line for it. This is something we continue to fight. It's not going to go away. It's a war of attrition. It's a winnable war of attrition, but it's something that needs to be taken very seriously. And with that, I'd be happy to take questions. I think they're going to bring a microphone for people so that everybody can hear.
I don't need a microphone.
Okay, go ahead.
What do we do?
Great question.
BDS.
Sure, great question. The question is, what can we do, meaning presumably people in the audience, about it? And I think that parents, community members, alumni have been unfairly shut out of the debate. If you ask the faculty on campuses who are pro-BDS, they view the involvement of alumni and parents and community members as an infringement on their academic freedom. Because what they don't understand is academic freedom does not mean freedom from criticism. So one is make your voices heard. It could be letter writing to the local newspaper. It could be attending events for Chalel or somebody else on campus. It could be using your donations wisely. You don't have to donate to a university, but you can ask that they earmark it to support programs that support interaction with Israel. There's a lot of different things that you can do, but get involved. And that's the thing that I would say more than anything. Get involved and make your opinions, and don't let them quiet you by saying that by outsiders criticizing what's going on, that somehow you're depriving faculty of their academic freedom.
Question? Yeah. When you see those videos on campus...
We're going to use the mic, but go ahead and then we'll start using the mic, okay?
All right, thanks. It makes me think it's time to bring the JDL back. What can these students do when they're harassed on campus? And as a lawyer, what are their legal rights? Can they retaliate against...
Sure. The question is, what can the students do when confronted with the sort of protesters that we saw in the video? And meeting that with violence is definitely not the answer, because that simply gets you in trouble also. And it's unnecessary, and it's a bad thing to begin with. But filing a police complaint, like the student did here, and I think it's going to go someplace. They are seriously investigating it. Writing about it and making it known what's going on campus, taking video, What are the students' legal rights? If you're assaulted, you should file a police complaint and you can sue the person. You
can't retaliate if you're assaulted?
I don't, you know, there's law of self-defense. I don't hold myself out as an expert on it. Certainly, if you're physically attacked, you might have some right of self-defense. That's very different than physically initiating contact with somebody, which I'm not certainly advocating. But I think that you have to go to your local pro-Israel groups, or you videotape it. I mean, all of these things, if they weren't videotaped, it would be like they never happened. So what are their legal, those are their legal rights.
If you have questions, why don't you come and line up back there? I'll be standing there so that we can have some order to this, okay?
I know you're focused on campuses, but also we have, for example, the other groups like the Presbyterian Church just passed a resolution and claim, you know, they love their Jewish brothers and sisters and just want their peace, but they're concerned about the oppression of the Palestinians. But that seems kind of superficial. There seems to be another agenda here, but that gets a lot of press also.
I focus mostly on campuses and in academia because that's where the movement is strongest in the U.S. There are some pockets elsewhere in the U.S. where the movement has taken hold. The American Friends Service, the Quakers, are among the most active promoting the BDS movement. They run, nobody knows that. They run a BDS boot camp over the summer where they train about 80 students to become BDS activists on campus. American Friends Service is among the most active. The Presbyterian, or I should say, and I'm not, I know there are different wings of the Presbyterian Church. So the one that passed the resolution is the Presbyterian Church of USA. I think that was the title. That doesn't represent all Presbyterians, but yes, there is a movement abroad to try to cut into what is a traditional religious Christian support for Israel. There is a deliberate and very active movement trying to turn that against Israel. And the way you stop it is to get engaged, to interact with people. And I don't think it's going to spread very far beyond the Presbyterian Church of USA.
Two questions. First, in respect to what you just said about the Quakers, what is it about the Quakers that they have been engaged in this anti-Israel movement for at least a few years now? Is it a small group within the movement, or is it the general Quaker movement that has become pro-BDS?
I don't know the answer to that. I just know that when I watch and I see what's going on, there is a group, American Friends Service Committee, or whatever it's called, that runs these boot camps and is very active behind the scenes. But I don't know enough about the Quaker movement in general to say whether it's widespread or not.
My second question is about the movement outside of the United States, particularly in England and elsewhere in Europe. It seems that places like Oxford University have been centers of anti-Israel and pro-BDS movement. Can you illuminate us a little bit about what's going on there? What can be done about that?
Sure. It's a much bigger problem in Europe than it is in the U.S., particularly in Ireland. One of those clips was from an Irish university. It's particularly bad in Ireland. It's pretty bad at many British universities. It's bad some places on the continent, although not as bad. So it is worse. But again, notice how it's mostly centered in universities. And in terms of non-university, there's been a lot of smoke, but not a lot of fire in terms of an economic boycott in the EU of Israel. Like I said, trade has actually expanded, and I think Israel very wisely is looking east now to India and to China. They won't be complete replacements for the EU, but they will lessen the blow if it ever got to that. But I don't think it will get to that with the EU, because they're trying to exert pressure for whether it actually happens. But there's no question that it's a bigger issue in Europe than it is in the US. And what do you do to counter it? Well, unfortunately, there's a group of people who are very organized, mostly non-governmental organizations. They're a group called NGO Monitor in Israel. You should go to their website, NGO Monitor, has tried to track the anti-Israel NGO movement. And these groups receive hundreds of billions of dollars a year. And you'd be surprised to know that most of it comes from European governments. And their sole job is to wake up every morning and find something that Israel did wrong. And then to get it into the newspapers through Haaretz in Israel or through West European newspapers, and to get it out there. And Israel, because of the EU funding, primarily EU funding, of these hundreds of non-governmental organizations, is under a microscope like no other country. That no other country could survive that sort of scrutiny. Because the way it works is, yes, Israel has problems like every society on earth. But when they're magnified, it would be like going over your skin with a microscope. It's you, but is it a fair presentation of you? And what has happened is for decades now, or particularly since this BDS movement started in 2001, Israel is under a microscope. Therefore, every normal human defect that is found in every population on earth gets magnified when it comes to Israeli Jews. And it creates a distortion. And the answer, it's not a problem that's going to be solved by passing a resolution or passing a law. It's got to be a process. It took 20 years to get here. It may take 20 years to turn it around.
Okay. I'm on the Rockford Israel Steering Committee, and I just wanted to thank you personally for being here and providing us with such a marvelous and thorough. I do have one question. You're so active in this area. Have you personally been threatened or intimidated or, you know, boycotted?
Well, I have been threatened, but not because of the Israel issue. Long before I was addressing the BDS movement, I was the only conservative on campus. And so I have been threatened to the extent that for graduation 2009, the university actually assigned a detective to accompany me to graduation because of threats. Had nothing to do with Israel, okay? Had to do with intolerance by people of opposing political views. I do get the nasty emails, but not that many anymore. And I've not so far received a threat with regard to the boycott movement. One of these days, who knows?
Dr. Jacobson, I'm going to ask a question. We got a couple more. I know there was some legislation in Albany and at the federal level in response to the American Studies Association, basically to counteract their intention of academic, it's kind of a reverse, to stop federal funding and state funding from going to these organizations, but I didn't really follow it all the way through.
Sure, and just for point of clarification, since this is being videotaped, I'm not a doctor. Just a lawyer who teaches. So a lot of people make that mistake. But the answer to the question is, and this was very unfortunate, and I was against it, and I wish someone had asked my opinion, but nobody asked my opinion. Right as we had mounted this movement to turn the tide against the boycott movement and to gather all these presidents and all these academic associations, a few politicians decided to photobomb our movement and get in the middle of it and propose blunderbuss legislation trying to punish universities if any of their funding went towards supporting the American Studies Association. And that was really too bad. Because what you then had happen is universities were then put in the position of feeling that their academic freedom was being violated, that we're going to strip you of all state funding if you pay for a professor to go to the American Studies annual meeting. So the people who were on our side now had to start defending the other people. And it did tremendous damage to what we were trying to do. It never went anywhere because they were overly broad, and it was ill-advised. And so the political process there actually hurt us. I do believe there are very narrowly tailored things that can be done legislatively, so long as, for example, tax-exempt status. I have challenged the American Studies Association's tax-exempt status because they're tax-exempt as an educational charity. And the boycott movement, I do not believe, meets the IRS definitions in their regulations. But I think legislation which narrowly addressed tax-exempt status, for example, could be useful. But the last thing we, those who are in favor of academic freedom, the last thing we should be doing is stifling other people.
Hi. Any of us who have taken our children on that grand tour to look for their ideal college can't help but notice that the names on the sides of the buildings at many of the major universities in this country that have been built over the last 30 years, the buildings that have been built over the last 30 years, have Jewish names. The place where I send my checks, which is University of Michigan, has a huge building that was built by Sandy Weill, and Stephen Ross then decided to build an even bigger building to outdo Sandy Weill. And I think that this is a pattern throughout the United States. The question I have is, we have many wealthy Jewish donors who are giving huge amounts of money to universities all over the country. They certainly could encourage the universities to divest themselves of these academic groups that wish to divest from Israel. Has anything been done to appeal to these people to see if they could become a weapon in our quiver?
I think the answer is not shutting out the groups who are critical of Israel. I think the best answer to the BDS movement has been what Israel's answer has always been to acts directed to destroy it, which is to build. So donate your money, but insist that it be used to support programs in Israel. Donate your money, but insist that it be used to bring Israeli academics over. As opposed to saying, I'm not going to contribute unless you're Middle Eastern studies program is closed down, or something like that. I don't think that's the ultimate answer, because one, you lose the white hat that you're wearing, and two, it's not an ultimate answer. The ultimate answer is to strengthen the ties with Israel, which is what's going on, and to talk to these large donors, and to let them know what's going on, and let them know that they need to help strengthen those bonds. For example, the Technion, Cornell Technion, has formed a cooperative agreement to build this enormous campus on Roosevelt Island in New York City. I think it's $400, $500 million, something like that. Obviously, that's not an everyday occurrence, but encourage your universities or start, you know, I know it's not as great as having your name on the side of a building, but start a program in your name which strengthens those ties. So I think building the relationship is the ultimate answer. What we do now is putting bandages on wounds, but it doesn't actually cure it. So build, build, build.
Professor, I have sort of a multifaceted question to present to you. You, throughout your presentation, spent the majority of it delegitimizing the BDS movement, making their claims, as well as their advances, ought to be minor accomplishments, which I find kind of ironic with a professor of your stature making this presentation.
I'd like to address the questions one at a time. I've never downplayed the importance of the movement. What I've said is that so far we have succeeded in containing it, and that it hasn't spread very far because some professors did great work at the Modern Language Association, etc. But if I gave the impression to anyone here that I think this is a minor issue or that it's one that's been solved, then I didn't mean to give that impression. Next question.
Now, in regards to the classification of Israel as an apartheid state, there have been several key leaders, including our former president, Jimmy Carter, Nelson Mandela, as well as Jews and Israeli Jews, including Gideon Levy, Max Blumenthal, Miko Pilit, who have classified Israel as an apartheid state. what would your rebuttal be to individuals such as those who have classified Israel as an apartheid state based on its flaws?
Sure, they're wrong. Yeah. Okay, let's start over. Authority. It's a logical fallacy. The fact, some of the people you've mentioned are prominent people, some of them are not, and I think people know some of the names that you mentioned, okay? And it's not my point to get up here and attack individuals, but some of the names you mentioned have no credibility in my mind, particularly one of the people you mentioned, okay, on Twitter approves of Photoshopped images of Theodore Herzl giving birth to Hitler, was so despised by the German Bundestag that they almost banned him, and he chased a legislator into a bathroom. And I'm not going to mention names here, but just Google, chase German legislator into bathroom. Okay, so you can hold people up as authority figures. And some of them are legitimate and certainly very prominent. But the fact that somebody was right about one issue at one time doesn't mean they're right about Israel now. And so I'll argue on the merits that Israel is not a perfect country. Neither is Jordan or Lebanon or Syria or Egypt or Saudi Arabia or Turkey. But it's not an apartheid state, it's not under apartheid state under the international law definition. And even the people who were making the comments, some of the people you mentioned, they are careful to say that it's not like South Africa, it's not exactly the same as South Africa, but it's kind of the new version of what apartheid means. And what I've said is that is a new version and a new definition that only gets applied to Israel. That's the problem I have with it.
Hi. I'm a mother of a daughter who's going to college next year, and I do pay attention to Ruth Collin at the very active media community, because that's where I put my money in, and that's because I want my daughter to stay. But I have a question, and the question is, what motivates the students and the faculty members to be involved with BDS? And I was just thinking about it, and I'm wondering maybe it's because they see it as low risk, high reward. What happened if we could change that to high risk and low reward? Would that speed up the deterioration of the BDS activity?
You've heard that there's a couple of questions there, and I think that the how did we get here? That's a question I always hear, and it's not uncommon after I give these talks, people will come up to me, and they'll say, and I'm talking about Jewish pro-Israeli people, they'll say, my son or my daughter, they're lost on this issue, that they drank the Kool-Aid, and they're lost, and. What can I do? And I said, you're asking me now? Where were you 15 years ago when you sent them into an educational system where they got fed this stuff in high school and throughout college? And 10 years later, they come out of that system and you're surprised? Well, get involved. That's one of the ways it got here. Why is it that the professors are this way? Well, there's always been a tendency in academia towards the radical. Nothing wrong with that. It's been that way forever, but there's an element of that radicalism that has taken place over the last 20 to 30 years, call it critical race studies, critical whatever, anti-colonial studies. It is people who frame the world in colonial versus non-colonial, anti-colonial terms. And they view Israel as a colonial imposition. And they hire people who think the way they do. And if you look at the departments in the humanities and the social sciences, not every single place, but in a lot of these places, there is a change taking place in the hiring process. And it's not an absolute truth, but by and large, faculty under 40 are probably much more inclined to absorb this anti-colonial theory put aside that Israel is not anti-colonial, it's the restoration of the original inhabitants. We could have that argument, but it's not, you know, like France taking over parts of Africa. And so they're over a generation in academia, they have hired people who ascribe to that. The biggest myth that's out there is that there is a pro-Israel bias in academia, in higher ed. Just the opposite is true. So many professors come up to me, or grad students, they are scared to death at being identified as pro-Israel publicly on the internet. If they do write for my website, they do it using a pseudonym, because they're scared to death, because they won't, their resume will never, using the old analogy of paper, it will never get off the desk. They won't even be interviewed if there's anything on there that is pro-Israel. They never get to the point that they're rejected. It just falls into this void. They're scared to death of it. And that has to change. I don't know how you do change it, because academic departments are very protective on those sort of hiring decisions, but it has to change. There has to be some adult supervision on this, because, and that comes from the administration, and faculty hate that, but it has to happen, because you have people who, just like they took over the American Studies Association, they want to take over their departments. Ultimately, that's why a lot of the most active BDS professors come from like the English department. At Cornell, the most active BDS professor is from the English department. And they hire their own. The English department, it works its way into prejudices other ways. I went to Vassar College to speak after they had, I don't have time to go into it, a horrible situation on campus. The week before I got there, several academic departments, including the Jewish Studies department, brought to campus to speak, one of the people who was mentioned in the question before, plus another person who runs a website called Electronic Intifada, and they were sponsored by academic units. I have no problem with that. I'm not seeking to keep them off campus. When the group that invited me asked those same departments to sponsor me, they refused. When the Cornell English department was a co-sponsor of Israeli apartheid youth last year, a Jewish student came to me and said, I just got an email from the English department promoting Israeli apartheid people. I feel really uncomfortable that my professors are injecting this into our class. I emailed the chair of the Cornell department. I said, I understand you're a co-sponsor, fine. I'm giving a talk next week sponsored by the pro-Israel group on campus. I'd like you to email all those same students promoting my talk. No response. I followed up. No response. Finally, I got a response, and it was like a non-response response, and they never did. And when those things happen, people need to speak up. I regret that I didn't. I should have gone public with it. I should have gone to the president of the university with it. I'm not opposed. If you're going to sponsor, as an academic unit, one side in this dispute, you should sponsor both. You don't have to sponsor any of them. That's fine, too. But you can't use your weight as faculty to intimidate your students. It's very different. You hear about this open Hillel movement. Now, Hillel should have to open its branches to essentially anti-Israel students. And I don't think that should have to happen, because it's not an academic unit. It's not part of the university. Just as I don't think Students for Justice in Palestine should have to invite me to speak. I'd be happy to, but they shouldn't have to. They shouldn't be forced to. And Hillel shouldn't be forced to invite somebody who is anti-Israel. But when an academic unit does it, it sends a message to students. And so the way you change this, and this is the longest-winded answer to a very short and clear question. The way you change it is by speaking up. And I really regret not going public with Cornell English department putting their thumb on the scale against Israel.
Just one quick question right here, and maybe two. First, the Palestinian charter, does that still call for the destruction of Israel, number one? And number two, this is a bit of a controversial issue here in the U.S. with Prime Minister Netanyahu coming to Congress. Is there an opportunity when Congress is so close to the people to work with your local rep to bring this issue to light with Prime Minister Netanyahu coming to speak to Congress?
Okay, on the issue of the Palestinian National Charter, I don't know the answer to that. I know the Hamas Charter does. I don't know if the Palestinian National Charter does. One interesting fact that you may not know, I didn't know it until a few months ago, and I couldn't believe it, so I went and I had to get a document from a Palestinian source, because I just said, this can't be right, I've never heard of this. The original Palestinian National Charter in 1964 disavowed any territorial claim to the areas controlled by the Hashemite Kingdom of Jordan, also known as the West Bank. Think about that. What we're arguing over now, and by the way, the West Bank was illegally occupied by Jordan, okay? Not only recognized by two nations, Britain and Pakistan. The charter that you read now is the 1968 version. It's hard to find the 64 version. Somebody sent it to me and I said, this has got to be a forgery, this can't be true. I found it on the website of the Palestinian consulate to the UN. So I think it's accurate. Think about that. What we're arguing now about, Israel's illegal occupation, Israel's apartheid state, all of these things is for territory that the sole and exclusive representative of the Palestinian people in 1964 said they had no territorial claim to. And one thing you've got to realize, and it's the frustrating thing for me, we are dealing with this fiction that has been created, whether it's apartheid state, whether it's Sabra Hummus being named for this Sabra Shatila massacre, whether it's all of these things, we are dealing with people who just make stuff up. It's propaganda. It's said for the impact it has, not for the truth that it has. That's the challenge we face, because we don't want to do the same thing. We want to acknowledge our own weaknesses and argue the facts of what actually happened. As to Netanyahu's visit, that's above my pay grade. Is that a good way of
it? Didn't work well for Tom Brady.
Any other questions?
Yeah, I'd like to make one suggestion. Have you talked to Ann Coulter at all?
Never spoken to her.
She's an alumna, isn't she?
Of Cornell, and so is Keith Olbermann, who, as she likes to say, went to the Cal College. The Ag School.
All right.
All right, great. Thank you very much.